content standards and pose the question there's a lot of them about, they're all in flux, so should we not just wait for them to settle down? And the short version of this presentation is no, we shouldn't. Okay, you probably want a bit more than that. So I'm going to make an assumption that most of you can drive, and therefore most of you will be familiar with the layout of a set of car controls. Now, of course, in real life, they're not labelled like this, but the point is this is a mature standard. This is a standard that has settled down. And what this means is when you learn to drive a car, your skill is transferable, because you could go to pretty well any car dealership or any rental shop in the world and drive away with pretty well any common make or model of car. The point being the standard is mature, so it's predictable and your skill becomes transferable. The Model T Ford is a very common make and model of car, and you'd actually struggle to drive one of those away from the rental shop because it doesn't conform to our modern standards. Its car controls are laid out differently. And in fact, drivermodelt.com insists on one-on-one tuition before they let you take one of these babies down the Pacific Coast Highway. The point being, in the early days of mass car manufacture, in the same as the early days of the net, there were no standards. You were confronted by tiller steering, handlebars, different pedal configurations, no pedals at all, and instructions in gibberish. But that did not stop the pioneers. Henry Ford famously said, "I don't ask my customers what they think because they'll tell me a faster horse." Point being, he was an innovator. He just got on with it, and he did not wait for the standards to arrive. He set up his factory, he pioneered mass production techniques, and the Model T Ford became a massive success. It remains to this day the seventh biggest selling model of motor car ever, and by the end of its production run, half the cars on the planet were Model T Fords. Clearly, Ford didn't need to wait for standards. And ironically, despite its success, its standards fell out of favor. It was actually the Cadillac Type 53. It was the first car that laid out its controls in what we now consider to be a standard style. And yet it ran for just a year and sold a tiny amount in the middle of Ford's dominance. So the point is, standards do come and go, but people can make money out of them in the meantime. Publishers have shipped product, for example, on the Palm family of devices. They're very much languishing in the where are they now bin of technology. Now, talking of shipping products, another way of considering standards is maybe to look at shipping products, and I think you'll be familiar with one of these. It is a shipping container, or more technically, an intermodal shipping container. It was designed to facilitate movement of goods between different forms of transport, and it addresses an historical problem. Back in the day, there was a big bottleneck in the transportation of goods because you had to load and unload everything manually, with all of the inefficiencies, additional costs, and various problems that that implied. Now, in the mid-50s, an engineer came along and designed a mechanized solution to this problem. He designed the loading gear, he designed various standard interlocking things, and more to the point, he came out with a standard container size. He started to lay the foundation for standards to help drive economies in the system. He patented that standard and then persuaded his employer to give the IP for the patent away for free. Why? He wanted to encourage the uptake of standards. And in actual fact, it succeeded. The standardized shipping container is now the foundation of our modern globalized economy. But just like Ford, Challenger standard is not used in modern day. Despite all the containers you see here, all the containers that we use, are actually running to slightly different dimensions. So the point is that modern standards bodies, I mean, here's the ISO standard for a shipping container, modern standards bodies won't even consider a standard until it's already in widespread use. So not merely shouldn't you wait for standards, you actually have to get on with it to get your particular thing established before you can get the standards established in the first place, if that makes sense. So my contention is basically digital content standards are basically shipping containers that allow us to move content between different media. And really that's all they are. The content actually continues to remain valuable. And how we render the content, well, you know, that's going to come and go. Some things are going to get consigned to the history bin. Some things are going to take us forward. We may actually find that there are multiple standards that end up coexisting, because in actual fact, some of them may occupy very specific niches. But it's the content underneath it all which we as publishers act on. And so my view is whether it's going to be an iPad or a Kindle or this new product that you'll see in the shops for Christmas, the Kindle Pad, kind of doesn't matter. We generate our value through the content we act on. So I come back to my first slide. Should we wait and see? Absolutely not. I think we should just get on with it.